Blog Talk Radio.
Oh, I love you so, my English friends, forever and ever until I leave this world. But I kind of feel trouble. The train is gone, but I'm going to catch the next one. Trouble in love. I'm blue, but I won't be blue always, because the sun is gonna shine on the door someday.
Good evening, everyone, and give thanks for tuning in to another Real Radio Talk. We have Dr. Runoko Rashidi on the switchboard, and he is on the line live from Los Angeles, California. If you're not familiar with him, he is a well-known scholar, lecturer, and traveler throughout the world, and he's traveled to so many different places from continent to continent, bringing out the black experiences within countries that you wouldn't think there are black presence, like Asia, Europe, and those, you know, hidden factors about black melanated people living and dwelling in those regions, even sometimes before the European even dwelled there. So, you know, he's on the line now, and we're going to have a positive dialogue and some education going on. That way you can get a a bird's eye view of exactly what he does and the type of information that he brings. You can also see him on YouTube, Dr. Runoko Rashidi, if you want to, you know, watch some of his lectures and documentaries. He's also an author, you know, a global truth seeker, researcher. So this is somebody that you're not going to normally get information from in the schoolhouse, you know, so you would have to step outside the box and listen to someone like him to get certain information that you will never get in at particular universities or colleges. Then we also have Landscurve Media on the line. Lance, you want to introduce yourself before we bring on Dr. Runoko?
Yes. I'm glad to be here. I'm really looking forward to what the great doctor has to share, because it's very important that we bring our experiences together, and I appreciate all the hours of travel and research and time spent to be the man that he is at this present moment and to share, and to have the spirit of love to share with us his precious findings. There's nothing like it, and most of us and more of us should appreciate him and men like him, and, of course, dear sister, yourself also on this platform. Thank you so much, and I look forward to a great dialogue, as my soul is hungry to hear what you have to share.
So is Brother Keston on the line, too? Maybe he would like to say
something? Oh, yes, he is. Yes, he's on the line also. He's driving right now, which is going to take him a second to say, but he's on the line. Go ahead, brother.
Yes, my sister. Peace and greetings to my brother. Truly appreciate all the hard work that our brother has done to enlighten us as black people. We really need these enlightenment, especially in the time that we're living in. So I am very grateful for the work that you have done, my brother, and I'm just going to be a student, a listener, you know, tonight, because I know that you have a lot of wisdom to share with us, and I truly appreciate all the greatness that comes along with all of this wisdom that has been placed upon brothers like yourself, because we need brothers like you to enlighten us and share this with us.
Right, so I know we all want to listen too, but if we have any questions that we might want to ask, feel free to ask, because we don't want to make it boring, you know?
Definitely.
All right, so Dr. Runoko, you know, if you want to come in and give yourself a brief intro, I guess added on to what I already said, you might have something that I didn't say that you would like to share to the listeners.
The mic is open. Not much to add. I'm pleased to be on the show. I'm a historian and I'm an anthropologist. 64 years old. I've been doing this work for about 45 years. I study all the time. I love black people. I'm a father. And I'm happy to be on your show. I hope it can be fruitful and productive for everybody.
Yes. And it's always a pleasure to have you here, because I know you're just coming back from traveling, so you probably would like to be resting, but you're back on the mic again talking. Yeah. So I was thinking,
well, how do you
know, I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, how do you want to begin?
Okay, yeah, I was thinking maybe we could start with, like, we can start with Africa, because I know most people is familiar with the original man from Ethiopia, Zimbabwe, and Ghana. But a lot of them is not really familiar with Zimbabwe. We always hear Ghana and Ethiopia. So maybe you can kind of touch on Zimbabwe and then move into the Asia area and then the Thailand, Japan, Australia, you know, African presence in early Rome, the San Andreas Islands, black Americans, you know, here on the continent,
no,
maybe.
That's a lot of work. Let's just start
well,
with a
know,
few of the basics and see where we
yeah,
go from there.
Exactly. Okay.
Well, humanity begins in Africa. That's the first thing. And we should never take that for granted. Before there was a Zimbabwe or Ghana or Ethiopia, there was a continent that we now call Africa. We are not certain exactly where the term Africa comes from. It may be an indigenous word used by the people themselves. There's a belief that circulated on the internet quite a bit, that Africa is named after a Roman general. Well, that's foolish.
Yeah,
the Roman general actually takes his name from Africa. So humanity begins in Africa, our most ancient forms of humanity, and then modern humanity as well. That's what DNA tells us. That's what the fossil evidence tells us. And then beginning about 100,000 years ago, African people, black people, begin to migrate to the far corners of the earth. Now, this doesn't mean that we are indigenous or aboriginal to any continent other than Africa. Everywhere else we got to, everywhere else we are, we started in Africa and ended up there. And I want to be very, very clear on that, because there's a lot of foolishness, lunacy circulating on the internet that we are not African, that we are aboriginal, we're born in parts of the world. We should just dispense with
that.
Yeah,
I hear that.
That's just ignorance. And it's fed by a lot of anti-African bias. We, in general, so many of us, are prejudiced against Africa, so that anything that comes our way that allows us to embrace the idea that we are something other than what we are, many of us jump on. I think also it's an effort to disassociate ourselves from the horrors of the transatlantic slave trade. So many people would deny that it existed or that we were always here. This is simply not true. And it's an insult to the bones, to the memories of all of those African people, those captives whose bones lie on the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean and the Indian Ocean as well. Because not only is there a transatlantic slave trade, there's an East African slave trade, and there's an Arab slave trade. But the migrations that I'm talking about now took place tens of thousands of years before slavery and before colonization. Also, since we're basically dealing with African history 101, African migrations 101, we should say that these movements of African people have nothing to do with what is called Pangaea. Pangaea is a supercontinent that held the entire world's land masses together. And this is true. But this Pangaea broke apart 150 million years ago. So it has nothing to do with modern humanity. So African people, the children of Africa, migrated to all of these parts of the world through their own ingenuity and through their own resilience. We are the original people, and Africa is the original birthplace of humanity. And there is only one race, and that's the human race, which originated in Africa and spread to the far corners of the earth and were affected by climates different than the ones that they had experienced. And this accounts for the different ethnic groups. But I assure you that Africa is the mother continent, and black people are the parent people of humanity. So we should begin with that. And on those issues, there's no debate, there's no discussions. We can ask questions about it, but anything to the contrary should not even be entertained as a serious discussion.
Yeah, because I hear even some Native Americans say that there were people on the planet during Pangaea that they would just walk from Africa to North America or South America. But then I hear scholars like yourself and other ones that said there was really no humanoids on the planet during Pangaea.
Well, we're just talking about what the evidence tells us. Now, many people believe many things. There are those of us who believe the world is flat, that human evolution is not real, that Jesus is waiting in heaven for all of us. So you could believe whatever you want. And I don't argue with people. Not at my age, as long as I've been doing this, I don't argue with people. I'm telling you what the evidence tells us. And the evidence is overwhelming. And when I say evidence or science, I'm not talking about a European thing. African people were the first scientists. So we should not run from science, we should run to it. And I think that we owe our people the honest truth, even if it's not what people prefer to believe. Yesterday was the birthday of one of our greatest historians. His name is Chancellor James Williams. He wrote a book that profoundly influenced me called The Destruction of Black Civilization. And in that book, he said many things. But one of the things he said that really resonated, and that is the African historian, which I think I am, must be on a relentless search for truth and must not tremble with fear when that truth is contrary to what one would prefer to believe. So we're not going to talk about fantasy, at least I'm not. We're going to talk about what the evidence tells us. And this line of the background, the foundation that I gave you, is pretty much what scientists agree on, African scholars, and those are the, that's the platform. I think we need to have a strong foundation. I believe there's an African proverb that goes, if you know the beginning well, the ending will not trouble you. So we should start at the beginning. So if we deal with that, we got that out of the way, I hope. And then if we want to continue to look at Africa, we can look at the role that African people have played in the development of classical civilization. It's one thing to say that you were first. It's another, as I was taught by my teachers, including people like Ivan Van Sertima, the great scholar who dealt more than anybody else with the African presence in America before Columbus. It's one thing to say that you were first, it's another thing to say what you did. And so African people are not only the first people on the planet, we did great things. And among the greatest thing that we did was develop the civilization along the banks of the River Nile. And this is what we call Kemet or ancient Egypt, Kush, Nubia, Ethiopia, etc. By the way, the word Ethiopia is a Greek name. It's not an African name. It's a Greek name that means the land of the burnt-faced people. And this is a term that is now applied to the modern country of Ethiopia. The country of Ethiopia today, the country of Haile Selassie I, has also been called Abyssinia. But when a lot of these countries in Africa, at least some of them, became independent, They chose to take on traditional African names, and in many cases, the names of ancient African kingdoms and empires. And so the country that used to be called, under the British, the Gold Coast, took the name of Ghana. The country that was a part of the French West Sudan took the name Mali. And we could say something similar about Zimbabwe. When Zimbabwe became independent, it changed the name from Northern Rhodesia, or Rhodesia, named after the arch-imperialist Cecil Rhodes, to Zimbabwe. And even the country of Benin in West Africa is similar to that. Benin, well, even then had an African name, Dahomey. But the name Benin comes from an African kingdom really associated with modern Nigeria. So those are a few more pieces of history that I think people should understand.
So then when
so,
you're talking about, oh, go ahead, sorry.
No, my sister, we're just getting used to each other's style. I didn't know if you were going to ask me questions or you expected me to lecture for a little while or what you want me to do and how we could be most effective.
Right, we could do a little both. I would definitely ask questions and, you know, whatever you feel like is important to make known, you can always feel free to say it. And then, you know, if Brother Keston or
believe
if
me,
Brother Lance would like to
believe
ask
me.
Any questions.
Believe me, I'll definitely step in and let you know where I think we should be going. But I think it would be better if you and the other co-hosts ask specific questions that I might try to answer and be most effective. What do you want to know?
Definitely.
Greetings,
right,
brother.
Let me.
Yes. Sorry. Go ahead.
I feel like a hungry man who
arrived to the all-you-can-eat buffet, but I'm so hungry I can't even decide what plate I want yet. So if you could just speak on a few if you could just speak on, my dear brother, some of the common fallacies and common misunderstandings about the continent of Africa and the various countries and cultures within, just for a few minutes,
okay,
that would jumpstart me into some very specific questions, because already I have to tell you, I love your energy. I love the methodical way you're going down the list and just stating what you're about. And we're going to rock and roll good tonight. But if you can, some of the things that irk you personally, like to say, my God, how could you be so ignorant to this? And some of the things that you hear about Africa, give us a few, and we'll jump on in with our specific questions. Thank you.
Brother, you know, we have so much, because we are taught basically, I think, to be anti-African, to instinctively reject Africa. Because African unity, black unity around the world, would be the end of the system that we call white supremacy. I mean, black people will come to power again. I think that if there's nothing else that we agree on, I think almost every black person would say, or at least the vast majority, that we need to unite, that black people have to unite. And so what can be the basis of that unity? A deep sense of pride in who we are. I think that no matter your gender, no matter your age, no matter your class, all of our people want to feel proud of themselves. I think that all of us, deep down inside, want to feel like we come from something bigger than ourselves. Something that will allow us to hold our heads up high and be proud of who and what we are. This is the key. If we are able to develop a deep-rooted knowledge of self, it will transform everything. And this is a very important point to make, because a lot of times people will ask, well, why is history important? We have so many problems, so many issues that we're trying to contend with right now. We really don't have time to talk about what happened 10,000 years ago or a million years ago or even yesterday. So it's very important to make it clear why knowledge of self is important, why this exercise is significant. So what I say all the time is, what you do for yourself depends on what you think of yourself. And what you think of yourself depends on what you know of yourself. And what you know of yourself depends on what you have been told. So if you are programmed, if you have been told all your life, 24/7, cradle to grave, womb to tomb, that you ain't nothing, that you come from nothing, that your people never did anything, you will act that out. And you will be prepared to embrace the worst ideas about yourself. You will embrace the N word. You will use the B word. It'll roll easily off your tongue because you don't know any better. But if you are taught to believe that you come from royalty, kings and queens, that you are the first people to give humanity to the world, civilization to the world, it changes everything. You begin to look at yourself in a different light, and you begin to look at people in your community in a different light. And that is why what we're doing is so important. Now, the key is not just the fact that it's important, but how do we instill that desire to want to know into the masses of our people? That's the difficult part. How do you inject a desire to want to know that we've done things in our community? And these things are really, 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 really basic. Now, in terms of Africa itself today, there are 54 sovereign, so-called sovereign countries in Africa. Notice I said so-called because they are European creations. Europe invaded and colonized Africa. And now those countries have some level of political independence, but economically they're still enslaved, and culturally they're still enslaved. In many ways, Africans in America, at least conscious African Americans, that's us, are more advanced in terms of African identity than most sisters and brothers on the continent themselves. because they had the same colonizer that we have. And we are all trying to throw off the shackles of mental slavery. So one of the things we must do is give our people a sense of pride in Africa. Then you wouldn't have folk talking about, I ain't no African, I'm an Aboriginal. And we must explore that fully. Now, the thing, I guess two or three things, and I'll shut up for a moment. Two or three things that really, you asked me, that irk me more than anything else. One, when I hear black people in the United States say, I'm not an African. I ain't got nothing to do with Africa. I didn't leave nothing in Africa. Now, that really is like somebody talking about your mother.
That's horrible. Yeah, that's
and then
horrible.
Number two, well, we can start with that. That's the key. We have to develop a deep love for Africa, because in loving Africa, we love ourselves. You can't hate the roots of the tree without hating the fruits of the tree.
Right.
Your turn.
Oh, okay. I'll jump in. You're right. I was very surprised. I was born in New York City. I reside in Orlando, Florida. Born in 63, 55 years old. Never been to the continent of Africa or any country therein. But I always assumed, as a person growing up here in my journey, that those from the many countries in Africa were more enlightened than me to what Africa was all about. It was a shock within the last, I'd say, 10 years, because I've been online a lot and I read a lot, but the online experience has affected me greatly, because now we have the ability to connect to people in live time all over the world without even as much as licking a stamp. So when I began to talk to people from the continent of Africa, born and raised, and look at the various websites that many of them had, and the buffoonery on a lot of the websites that they had that mirrored what we have here, comparable to reality TV shows, celebrity worship, the decadence of the colonizer, it was disappointing to me. And in my dealings with many from, and I know many from Nigeria and Ghana, especially when I was in New York City and hustling after work, driving a taxi cab and dollar van, I got a chance to really hang out with many of them. And what happened in those personal dealings, they prostituted the fact that I thought that they were righteous black brothers from the motherland and ripped me off faster than somebody would over here. I was like, wait a second. These are the guys from Utopia, from the motherland? And they played that on me. I'm not saying all, because I met some very wonderful brothers who are conscious from over there in the various countries, but that was a rude awakening for me, and it let me know how far and wide the tentacles of white supremacy and the colonization, not just of a physical country, but of our black minds across the globe and diaspora. So now I have to weigh you out as an individual. So when many of my black brothers from Africa would say, hello, my brother, how are you doing? Oh, my black brother, I am so proud. We must unify. Okay, yeah, all right. Now you need $50 from me. Okay. You know what I mean? Nobody's perfect, but I thought that coming from a place that was more original, you know, the source, more so than me growing up in Southside, Queens, New York City, I said, man, these guys got to really be enlightened. But that wasn't the case, I hate to say, 9 times out of 10. And that's how I've come to know how powerful white supremacy has been, and the tricks and the minefields they put out there, even controlling our schools and how we think and get into our children, and now more so with this LGBT thing. All of this stuff thrown at us, and we're gobbling it up like pigs. Who's left, my brother? What must we do? Please tell me, what must we do when we have this type of mindset, where we have the Stockholm syndrome going on, where we can't let go of the oppressor and we'll defend the oppressor to the detriment of our own existence? Please tell me.
Well, I think knowledge of self, as I pointed out, has a lot to do with it. But I think you also have to want change. You see, I think that maybe what we do best And what we do most is become indignant, and we express outrage when one of our youth, doesn't even have to be a youth, is shot in the streets with both hands raised up in broad daylight begging, don't shoot. We become very angry, and we should. Our condition is messed up in general compared to the other larger population. But does that translate into wanting to make changes enough to destroy white supremacy? And I don't think that it does. I think that in many ways we have become comfortable, or we have acclimated ourselves to white supremacy. For example, you ask, what should we do? I think that we have to do all of the really, really basic things. But that means if you're going to do those things, you have to change a lot of the things that you are doing right now. For example, I believe that it's very important that black men be with black women. To me, that's very deep. And that is the greatest statement you can make by the person you choose to walk by your side. And yet,
yes,
a brother, a lot of brothers who are racially profiled from cradle to grave, I mean, from the beginning to the end, the last one to get the job, first one to get fired. You know the things that we go through. Typically, even the first one to get killed in the movie. When I say something like that, they are likely to say, I couldn't help who I fell in love with. And I don't see color, that I don't see race. You understand? If I say we need to spend more money with other black people, this is very big, even if you're going to get into the quote-unquote Christmas spirit, which if that's what you want to do, I'm not going to fight you, at least spend some money with black folk to be willing to join an organization with like-minded people. We say we are at war, but we don't seem to be very effective warriors if it's too cold, or if it's too late, or if it's too far, or if I have to spend some money, or if I have to work with people in my community that I don't like. Now, you say you're at war, but you won't get involved in a particular program or organization because you don't like somebody for what they did to you 10 years ago. You see, so my attitude is we're not very serious about empowerment. We're serious about talking about it, but in terms of changing our behavior on an individual level, we are sorely lacking in that, in general.
And you know,
so
I
in
have
essence,
mentioned that
the change must come within.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
From
go
within.
Ahead.
Go ahead, sister. Go ahead, sister.
No, finish what you were saying.
Let me summarize. Let me just say this. It's not that we need a plan. I think that we need a philosophy, a kind of a race-first philosophy that I'm going to start with myself and my community. That doesn't mean I have to hate anybody. Hate is a burden that I wouldn't wish on anybody. But it means we have to love ourselves enough to be selfish sometimes and to look within and ask ourselves, what are the things that we do that enable white supremacy? Stop giving white people all of your money and marry somebody who looks like you and spend money with people who look like you and who live in your community and join an organization of like-minded people, because you can't conquer white supremacy by yourself. And even if you make a mistake, get up and start all over again. Don't tell me that you won't do business with a black person because you had a negative experience, and then go spend your money with the descendants of the people who enslaved your ancestors. So until we are prepared to get serious about basic things like that, maybe stop being so judgmental of other people and try to be a better example or an ambassador for the things that we say we believe in. These are the basic things that ultimately will liberate us. But we have to purge ourselves of so many negative attitudes and values that have been instilled in us for generations on both sides of the Atlantic. Now, you talked about some of the shortcomings of sisters and brothers on the continent, but you could go to Brazil and see something similar to that. You could go to Jamaica and see something similar to that. You could go to Haiti or Mexico and see the same kinds of things. And these things also make you realize that we are all in this together and that we have to spend more time talking about where white folks picked us up from instead of where we dropped, where we got dropped off. And we have to be able to see the big picture. Put aside our pettiness, our egos, our jealousies, and learn to look at the big picture. I know those things are easier said than done, but that's in essence, those are the things that we are grappling with. Now, what I try to do is use history to motivate our people, to give them a guideline, a sense of direction, a sense of the possibilities of what we can do. And it's having an impact. I give you an example, and I'll leave it, I'll rest for a moment. One of the most interesting things that's happened to us in the last couple of years or so is this movie Black Panther. It is not a perfect film, but it's a very, very powerful film. And it showed one thing and illustrates my point, the sense of a desire to be proud, a willingness to embrace Africa, even by people who are not in the so-called African conscious community. I saw sisters and brothers that I would never see at one of my lectures, never see in a program, put on their African dashiki, may have been made in China, and wear it to the premiere of the movie and be proud of it, and doing the Wakanda salute. These things are very, very powerful, and I think we can learn from that. All right.
Yeah, because I know a friend from New York was telling me that when he went to see the Black Panther movie, that the movie theater was full. And not only was it full, but everybody had on an African garment. So it kind of like woke up some DNA cells that was dormant and made people start feeling like they belong somewhere. You know, like I am somebody. I am more than just going to jail on drugs, you know, or selling drugs. I could be in a superhero movie and show the greatness of Africa, because they're always showing us the downside of Africa to make you not want to visit. But they don't want to show you the uplifting side of Africa. So you're right about that. Black Panther really, you know, it woke up a lot of people that you wouldn't even expect to go out and buy an African garment to go see the movie. Like, nobody goes to the movies with an African garment on. But when Black Panther movie came out, people felt the need to do that. Well, that does says a lot, you know.
Mm.
It does. But I
would
say,
well, I think that
Go ahead.
Yeah. I just want to interject on that. I'm always looking to connect dots that sometimes don't always exist. And I agree with everything that you both say, because it's a start. But I'm saying to myself, what if Disney was the one to facilitate this movie at the core? And my thing is, would black people have accepted it if it was a totally, totally black production? Second of all, it's wonderful to see our black brothers and sisters proud of their culture and to make that initial connection. But who profited off of this? The garments they had on, was it from the Philippines or China, were they made? Not to be negative, but all I'm saying is that that is a start, but why couldn't have Disney, since Disney was the one to back this up, or maybe next time, bring us out of the comic book rendition and bring us into the true history so that we can connect with something that is real? You see, at the end of the day, you know, to me, this was a imitation African black thing to grab our subconscious minds to eventually steer us away from the path of the reality. Now, that being said, the wonderful doctor on the line right now, why isn't he more in demand to speak? Why isn't he taken care of for all of his work? And I know it's a passion for you, brother. It's not a money grab. But why aren't you called in for interviews on all of these Disney-connected mainstream media platforms from what you know? because I know there's nobody connected with that production that knows more than you. This is not an ego thing or an ego stroking thing. But let's get to the real. That was cool, but there's much more out there beyond what Stan Lee, the one who just passed away from Marvel Comics, created. Why don't we get to the core, and how do we get people to see that at this point?
Well, what we might say is, and you've already said it basically, but I'll put it in another way, that empowerment is a process. It's not an event. And it's not just one thing. It's many things. And it takes a long time. And it takes a sustained effort. I said at the beginning that Black Panther was not a perfect film, but it contributed a lot of positive things. For example, all the women in the film had natural hair. And that was even a part of the movie that they made a big deal out of that. They never used the N-word in the film. They never used the B-word in the film. People had respectful relationships in terms of the male-female thing. Now, certainly it's not the end of the line, but I think that we must also celebrate our victories, even though they may not be as monumental as we would like, as we work towards the end goal. Now, there's another issue, and I'm sure that we agree with this, that the struggle that we are in today didn't start yesterday, and it's not going to end tomorrow. No matter how hard we work, it's going to take time. It's going to take generations. But each generation must contribute to that. And each individual, or at least as many individuals as possible, must contribute to that. Nobody can do everything, but everybody can do something. So I think that all of us who are really sincere, and I think I'm preaching to the choir here, or we wouldn't be having this conversation, must look within and ask ourselves, what can I do to contribute to the struggle? What is it that I'm going to do today? How is it going to advance my people, my community? And ultimately, that's what it will take to bring about real change. And I don't see us as being at that point, but we can't give up the fight. We can't slip back any further than we already have. So we have to do it. Now, most of the time, I'm positive and optimistic about our future as a people. Most of the time. But there are times, I confess, I get depressed like a lot of other people, that is discouraging. And I even wonder sometimes if we are already defeated, but just haven't acknowledged that. But even during those moments of despair, when I am suffering that level of depression, I continue to fight anyway, because I believe that my ancestors, who paid such a price for us to be here, and future generations deserve a fight. And if I'm going to lose, I'm going to go down swinging. So yeah, we have to be critical. We have to look at the big picture. We have to be willing to analyze, but we also have to push the positive and celebrate our victories whenever we find those.
You know,
excellent.
Yesterday I was at this, at a like a book meeting and reading The Destruction of Black Civilization, and we're like down to the last chapter of the book, and someone had asked, "Are we separatists? Like, you know, who's the real separatist, the white man or black people?" That was one of the questions Chancellor Williams asked, but then the moderator was just repeating it. And, you know, people had their different views and opinions on what it is, but a few of us, including myself, agree that Black Wall Street is a good example of being a separatist, because they managed to come together, put their money together, and build something for themselves. And it took unity and trust to do that. And although we have these book meetings every other Saturday, we still haven't came to that conclusion to say, let's do what Black Wall Street did. We do a lot of talking, but the action is missing. We do a lot of dialoguing. We do a lot of agreeing. We all come up with the same answers, basically, maybe just wording it differently. But at the end of the day, when we get up from that table, Dr. Runoko, there's no Black Wall Street plan. although we know what we need to do. The book tells us, and we know it too. But when we get up from that table, it's the same talking and no action.
Well, what do you want me to tell you, my sister? You know, people ask me all the time about plans. I say it's not the plan. Easy to come up with a plan. That ain't no big deal. It's the implementation that's hard. Because, again, that means changing the things that we've been doing. For example, you know, I'll put the spotlight on me right now. We need to be much, and I'm saying we and speaking generally, but I'm using myself as an example. I need to be much more health conscious. I'm 64 years old now. I have a lot of work to do, but I don't take very good care of myself. And I can use excuses that I travel all the time. Yes, I just got back from Europe yesterday. Okay, I flew like 15 hours, you know, to get here. So when you reminded me about this interview today, it wasn't exactly, you know, what I wanted to hear, but at least I'm able to sit back and relax and do it over the telephone, and I think it's a conversation that's important to have. But I don't eat like I should. If I'm in a healthy environment, I'll be healthy. But most of the time, I'm eating, quite often at least, I'm eating junk food. I'm not exercising like I should. Now, you know, I can blame white supremacy till the cows come home. I can call white people all kind of devils. But at the end of the day, it's kind of my responsibility to act on that and to do better. So, you know, revolution comes from within. I've been saying empowerment, but we're really talking about revolution here. We're talking about a fundamental change, and that's not an easy thing to do. So I'm working on that.
Since you mentioned your health and things like that, and I understand how it is when you're traveling, you can't really get that decent, healthy meal that you would like to get. I mean, I could send you some sauerkraut leaf every month, and while you're traveling, you can make a gallon of that and have it in your traveling bag, and you can be drinking that while you're traveling because it also keeps the pressure down and the cholesterol down, and it's good for if you're suffering with any kind of diabetes, it'll get rid of that and detox the body, give you regular bowel movements, and just give you energy to where you probably won't even have an appetite most of the time because you're on the go anyway, and then you're drinking.
Send me some. Let me know. We can do that offline.
Right.
No, we can do it offline. Send me a message or whatever.
Okay.
No, after the interview, we can talk. Let me know what the costs are and all of those things because I need help. I'm willing to admit that. But I'm also using that as an example about how I think in all of our lives there are changes that we can make. Or we could ask ourselves, am I doing the best? Am I operating at optimum level? You know, because it's not just about me, it's about we, it's about collectivity. So, you know, I love black people, and I expect a lot of us from us, but also I think a lot of times I'm brought down by the realities that we are confronted with, and I'm just determined to go on and do the best I can. Now, let me say two or three other things real quick. Since we're just having a general discussion, and I'm maybe trying to offer some advice based on my experience, as I pointed out, we must be prepared for generations of struggle. Generations of struggle. That what we're going through didn't just happen yesterday. It ain't gonna start. It ain't gonna end tomorrow. We can't do it by ourselves. No matter how strong we are, we need organization. We need a collective effort. Maybe you are an example of that by pulling the various people together to be a part of this program. I think, too, that you cannot allow yourself to get frustrated. I'll put it this way. You can get tired, but you can't quit. You can take a break. You can sit back. You can regroup. You can rest yourself. You can rejuvenate yourself, but you can't give up. And so, I mean, these are basic kinds of things, and we have to keep a lot of that in mind.
I got one question for you, my brother. I know in the start that you said that, you know, where all of us come from. But my question is, my question to you is this, where this mindset that white supremacy have and continue to use against us as people, where did that mindset come from?
Well, we are the parents of white people. They, in essence, are our children. And they've gotten out of line. And they need to be disciplined. In order to do that, we must have the power to do it. African people walked out of Africa and went into Europe and got caught up in that ice. And they were transformed physically and psychologically. There's only one race, and that's the human race. But those Africans that got caught up in the ice, the ones we today call white people, have developed a cold, hard personality, a desire to want to be in charge, aggressive, speaking generally, greedy, a determination to dominate, what we might call a God complex. The African, on the other hand, the original people, developed a very different mentality. We have a strong live and let live personality in general. We are prepared to embrace almost anything and everybody. You know, we almost have to be, we shouldn't have to have a conversation where we almost have to argue and beg and plead for black people to want to marry other black people, to want to spend money with other black people. It's almost like we have to have a fight in our community to do that. If I say we need to spend more money with other black folk, the average black person starts to say, why? Why do I need to marry another black person? I think more than any other group of people on the planet, it's almost like we have to be beat over the head to want to do for self. And so I think that it's basically an incompatibility of culture and cultural personalities. And the only way to change that is to have power. That's really what it's about. You know, I wish white people liked me. But the most important thing is, yeah, I wish they did. I wish everybody loved Runoko Rashidi. But the most important thing is that I have enough power so that whether they like me or not, they can't mess with me. They can't do anything to me. Now, if they don't want to like me, that's their problem. But if they have the power to take that dislike and do something bad to me, that's my problem. So the essence of it is to gain power. That's really what it's about. That's what black power is all about, to have the power not to bother other people, but to have the power so nobody can mess with you and you can achieve your full potential in life. That's really what it's about. That's the essence of it. That's what we're striving for. And we just have to figure out what forms that is going to take and then be prepared to implement it. And we're a long way from that. But I'll say this too now. What keeps me from completely losing hope, completely losing all my optimism about the future, is that, again, I realize what we have gone through as a people. Look at all the brutalities that we have suffered for hundreds of years. Every kind of disrespect and humiliation and degradation, all of those things have been done to us. And yet we are still here tonight to have this conversation about how we're going to regain our rightful place in the world. That's a miracle. We are a miracle as a people. It's miraculous. Being taken out of the door of no return and being taken across the Atlantic Ocean on ships like the good ship Jesus, and serve Jesus daily, and John the Baptist, and fraternity, liberty, and equality. These were the names of some of the ships. And to survive breeding farms, the separation of families, babies being torn apart, all of the things that we went through, Jim Crow, all kinds of incarceration, all that stuff, and we're still here tonight. No, that's really amazing when you think about it. So that gives us hope, tells us that we are survivors, that we are mighty strong folk, and that we are capable of doing anything and everything if we set our mind to it and we learn to work together.
Wow.
I do definitely agree with you with that, you know, that we are a resilient people. Basically, it's almost to say that it's impossible to exterminate black people from off this planet. You know, we have to give thanks for that. And yes, you know, for me, I never lose hope. You know, that's one thing I can say personally, that I don't lose hope, because I know that we're going to win, but it's not going to be easy. And I think a lot of us are, what I think a lot of us is afraid of is actually doing the work to get set ourselves free from this thing called white supremacy. We have to be willing to do the work.
Yeah, brother, but we all agree with that. But work is no joke. It would be nice to be able to sit and smoke a joint and watch the game and just have a good life and do nothing. You know what I'm saying? I'm being real here. But you got to work. You talking about being in an organization, dealing with other people that you don't like, you know, changing your lifestyle. That's serious stuff. And, you know, and we're just not there at this point. And you know, I tell you what else, too. It's very easy to be judgmental of other people that don't have the consciousness that we think we have. Okay, it's very, very easy to look down on people who don't have the level of consciousness that we think we have. So I tell you, you know, it's a struggle. And you need to try to surround yourself with like-minded people who can reinforce you. Now, my brother, you say you never get discouraged. You always have hope. We need to clone you, brother. See what you're doing over there, man, because I tell you, sometimes black people make me scratch my head, man, and say, what the heck is going on here with our people? Because we do some crazy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That is true, my brother. I do agree with you that the things that we do, ever that we do with that. But what I look at, some, you know, for me, especially in these days, when I find I'm coming more across people who are coming to this awareness of who they are. And I find it in the younger people right now, you know, that they are coming to an awareness of self. The older generation, I think sometimes it's very difficult to deal with as regards to this. Because
Watch out, because I'm in the older generation, you know, so you have to watch when you're talking to old people. But I hear you, and that's very positive. Let me ask you something, brother. Let me ask you. I'm listening to your accent. Where are you from?
I'm from Jamaica, my brother.
Okay, very good. Well, you know, we're talking about Pan-Africanism. You know, that's positive. You know, the greatest man in the history of Jamaica, in my opinion, at least in modern times, is Marcus Garvey. Jamaica's a small island, relatively speaking, that's produced so much. Peter Tosh and Bob Marley and Marcus Garvey, this whole thing about African consciousness. And so now we have Africans from the Caribbean and Africans born in America. I assume the rest of y'all are born in Babylon. At least having this conversation, maybe the most important thing we can do is just talk to each other with love and tolerance and appreciation and not feeling like I have to be right all the time and have the last word. That's not easy either. So, you know, I think that we just have to continue to do the most basic things. Now, as you say, there's a new generation. I accept that. And each generation has their turn to do well, to make triumphs, to have defeats and setbacks. So, you know, I say go for it. You know, I don't think that my generation has to stand in the way. You know, if I can advise, if I can assist in any way that I can, I'm for it. But I think it requires all generations. I think it requires a collective effort on the part of our community, all young, male, female, to really do what must be done.
I absolutely agree with you, my brother, with that. You know, what I was going to say is that basically, you know, yes, you know, brothers like yourself, I do have great respect and admiration for the work that your brothers are spearheading. Brothers and sisters alike really are spearheading, because we don't want to forget about the sisters, because there's a lot of sisters out there that are doing great work. So for me, it's appreciated. But what I'm saying is, when I'm telling the brothers, when you see young people coming into this conscious thought about self and about Africa and about awareness, we have to encourage them, because we are running a relay race, so we have to pass the baton on to them, you know. But we have to give them, because our ancestors, as you said, never stopped fighting for us, no matter how tired they got, no matter what they went through. They was fighting for us to set us free from this oppression of white supremacy.
Well, I agree with you for the most part. But I think, too, that we have a tendency to, I don't know, maybe I'll see if I can put it this way. I'm confident that in spite of everything, that Marcus Garvey must have got tired and frustrated sometimes. I would imagine, I could be wrong, that Harriet Tubman must have been, she must have been afraid from time to time. I would imagine, I'm pretty confident that Malcolm X had doubts sometimes. But to me, what made them even greater, or what really is the essence of their greatness, is that in spite of their doubts and fears and frustrations, which I'm sure they had like any human being has, they didn't stop. They kept on going. And that, to me, is something I think that we have to allow people to be human. I don't even try to hide my humanness. I have strengths, great strengths, but also I have weaknesses. I'm a person. And I think that we have to, you know, recognize the totality of ourselves and at the same time challenge ourselves to be better and do better and to reinforce, you know, the struggle. Because you can't defeat white supremacy by yourself. We need a collective effort. I think there's an African proverb that goes, if you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. And we need each other. Whether we like each other, I may not even like you. And that's not so important. But am I able and willing to work with you for the common good? And that's what I mean by seeing the big picture. I love these African proverbs. They teach us so much. There's another one that goes, I pointed to you the stars in the heavens, but all you saw was the tips of my fingers. One of the great things, one last one, Marcus Garvey. Garvey, his motto was, up you mighty race, you can accomplish what you will. Africa for the Africans, those at home and those abroad. Garvey was born in St. Anne's Bay, Jamaica. He wasn't born in Africa. And someone asked him once, Mr. Garvey, are you an African or are you a Jamaican? And Garvey said, I will not give up a continent for an island. In other words, Garvey could see the big picture. And we want all of us, as individuals and collective, to be able to see the big picture.
That's right.
I thank you for sharing a bit of information. I just wanted to interject. My father's from St. Anne's, and that made me feel good to hear that Marcus Garvey's from there. Go ahead, Brother Keston.
Really? Your father was from St. Anne's Bay? Oh, wow.
Okay. St. Anne's Bay, but St. Anne's, Jamaica, actually Brownstown, but you know, close enough to know. He was born in 1916. He passed in 1990, and he taught me
wow.
a whole lot about Jamaica
wow.
and history and everything. So, and also I have to say that Brother Keston is my brother-in-law, and I married a black woman, and that's his sister. And don't let my accent fool you. I might be from New York, but I'm more of a worldwide person, conscious.
That's okay.
Well, I like all of that stuff. I like all of that, you know. I told you I traveled all this distance yesterday, and the reason I did that is because my daughter lives in southern France. Her mother has Senegalese roots. She's 13 years old. I have one child. I became a father at the tender age of 51, and I'm a very devoted
wow.
father. So I traveled all the way to France to get her and bring her back here so she can spend time with the sisters and brothers and her family here, and then I take her back.
Wow.
So I'm
wow.
you know, I think that That's what I mean when all of us have a contribution to make. So, brother, what you're talking about, I'm proud of you. And I think that's wonderful. And I think that you all sound like very good role models.
Okay.
Yes, we are.
Well, I'll let the, you know,
I try
Brother Keston is a role model to me. And like I said, I've had many role models, but he inspires me. And I'm just blessed to have him in my life. And also I have to say, from this point on, when I hear the Diana Ross song, Ain't No Mountain High Enough, I'm going to think about you, Doctor, because for you to go all the way to France, come back and bring her back, you embody the spirit of that song. But go ahead. I know Brother Keston had something that he had to say.
No. I really agree with the brother. And basically that it's going to take, I know that, you know, to build a nation, it's going to take all of us coming together. It's not about me. It's not about you. We have to put self aside in the sense where, you know, we come together, we help each other. We, you know, just like I often say, the Chinese people, when it comes to them and the way they deal with business and spend their money, they might not like this person, this Chinese person, but they are going to spend their money with them rather than go spend it somewhere else because they realize it's about their nation. It's not about any one individual. So I do wholeheartedly agree with you that all of us, whether we are in Jamaica, whether we are in Haiti, whether we are wherever we are in America, wherever, we all must come together as one people because that is the solution. We have to stop running away from ourselves because what we are running from is what we need to run to, and that is what is going to solve the problem. That is, in my estimation.
Right.
Let me ask you all something. All of you all are in Florida?
Yes.
Yes, my brother.
Just
and you're
parts.
In her.
I'm in Miami.
Yes.
Oh, you're in Miami. And the other folk?
And Keston.
Orlando.
Both me. Yes. Keston and I
okay.
are both in Orlando. I'm a New York
you see?
Transplant.
I didn't realize that there was a connection between South Florida and what Orlando is considered North Florida.
Well, Central Florida, actually.
It's more like
and
Central.
Florida is a strange place because when you, no matter where you slice it, you'll always come out with a slice of something that looks different or tastes different than the rest of the state. The Panhandle is a different country. South Florida basically is a different country to generalize in Central Florida, and you have pockets of consciousness here and there, but Florida is not just one place as far as a mindset or mentality. To me, Northern Florida, the Panhandle, is really Southern Georgia. You know, Miami
right.
is closer to New York City in its spirit than Central Florida. Central Florida is like the young kid who wants to be the grown man, so he wears clothes a size too large or, you know, stuffs clothes or socks in his biceps to make his arms look bigger. So they're trying to grow and be a big city, but there's a lot of transition going on here. Not to change the subject, I just want to say, since maybe you might not have known, but Orlando is the fastest growing metropolitan area in all of the country. I'm not saying the whole country
wow.
is moving down here, but statistically it is number one, the number one destination. So most have a misguided perception of Orlando because they see the travel brochures and they see Disney and the tourist attractions and they think that is it. And yes, there are a lot of wonderful looking places here, but it is a very racist place nonetheless, especially with white supremacy in the system here. Don't get locked up here. You know, you don't want that. But if you know how to live, you can live anywhere. Like I tell my wife and I tell Brother Keston, you can take me anywhere. You can drop me anywhere in the world because I know at this point in my life what I like, what I don't like, and what it takes me to live. That being said,
mm-hmm.
there's a lot of indecisive people who are transitioning, coming through this place. And it's a lot of turnover. It's a lot of activity here on all levels. It's not settled yet. It's a lot of things going on. And I'm not a doomsayer, but I don't think, you know, I don't want to be here when I transition. Put it that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you have a lot of history in Florida too.
Oh, most definitely. Most definitely. But what I'm saying is that the present climate, and I just I want to focus to stay on you and what you have to, it's not about I just want to say that any metropolitan area, any big city, I wouldn't want to be around. I don't like depending on things, or even depending on things other than nature. If those things are removed, it's going to be mayhem. And there's a lot of people who are very unstable here. These people, most here, are depending on the dream and illusion of this great new place called Orlando. But it's everywhere. And I don't like it here. And I'm a city person. You know, it's not a problem dealing with the usual things, but what I see it going into. Yes, the history is great, but the present doesn't look like it has much promise for me. Too many superficial people, too many people who are blinded, too many people who are caught up in the matrix, and I don't like that. And it's not just Orlando, but it's many places, you see. I want to go back to nature. I want to be free out of this on so many levels. And when I do deal with somebody, I want to be able to deal with them on an equal level where we have a certain mindset, because I can quickly see energies that are not good for me to be around. But that being said, that's a whole other show. And I just want to pick your brain, brother, because all these years of research that you did is a lot more important than my little journey in Florida. So let's go.
No, it's all important. It's all important. I was the one who asked the question.
I had my wheel spinning. I was listening.
No problem.
No, you look here. I'm a student, and I'm trying to learn. I know I'm a teacher, but I'm also a student of life and for life. So yeah, I was the one who asked the question. I find it all fascinating.
True.
Let me make one comment about a chapter among many in the history of Florida that's very, very interesting. Now, we talked about, we began talking about ancient Africa, the primordial migrations out of Africa before enslavement. And I try to focus most of my energy when I'm doing presentations on the period before slavery, because a lot of us don't even know if we have a history before slavery. I would challenge each of you, anybody who's listening, you can try this if you like. Ask anybody on the street, if you dare, any black person, to name a single black person in the world who lived before slavery. A lot of us would be hard-pressed. If you really thought about it, you might say King Tut or Cleopatra or something like that. But generally, we start our history after enslavement. As a matter of fact, one of the things I do is I lead tour groups. My first group next year will be to West Africa. We visit Benin, Togo, and Ghana from the 27th of January till the 10th of February. People still might want to go. I'll leave my information, and anybody can contact me, go to my website, etc. But my point is, if we're going to talk about enslavement, and we must talk about it, we could talk about resistance to enslavement. And so one of the most interesting and inspiring aspects of resistance occurred in Florida, and you may know more about this than me, with the people called Seminoles, who were Africans and Native Americans who fought a sustained war of liberation against the United States for 150 years. Some of them were never defeated in battle and ended up migrating out of Florida through Georgia, Arkansas, Texas, and ended up in Mexico, where their descendants are today. So, I mean, Florida is an interesting place. It has a lot of history. And I would love to do a show where we do talk about the African history of Florida, ancient and modern. I would also like to get down there more often. I have so much to share. Tens of thousands of original photographs, many of which I've never shown anyone. So I have a great desire to teach, share, and I would love to spend more time with you all talking about those kinds of things. I'm honored to be on your show, and you know, I hope it's just the first time of many that you guys have me on.
You're stuck with us.
Yeah, you just took the words out of my mouth, because that's the next thing I was going to say to Brother Lance and Keston. Like, we need to get Rashidi there in Orlando. And possibly in Miami, too. And back on the air, of course. to speak on the same history of Florida.
How much more time do we have for tonight?
We have about 45 more minutes.
All right. Well, what are some of the? It's okay. Let's make it effective. In that 45 minutes, perhaps you could ask some specific questions, and I'll try to give more concise answers. You know, what do you want to know? What do you think the audience wants to know? Specifically, what do you want me to try to address from a historical or anthropological perspective?
You want to touch a little bit on the ancient Americas? And that will give them
Why not?
For when you come on and do a full show, you know?
All right, let me talk about maybe what we could do is just a few minutes to deal with each landmass. We could talk about the African presence in early Asia or Asia in general, in Europe, in the Americas, Australia, and the Pacific Islands. We've already talked a little bit about the great civilizations of Africa. We started with the Nile Valley, but of course you also have the great civilizations in ancient Ethiopia. You mentioned Zimbabwe. We could talk about Carthage in what is now Tunisia. And most of us have heard at one time or another about Mali, Ghana, Songhai, the Kingdom of Benin, or Edo in Nigeria. But a lot of us are not aware that you have an African imprint or impact on all the other parts of the world before, during, and after enslavement. The Americas are no exception. We know that the first people in the Americas were people of African heritage. There's no mistake about that. DNA tells us this. The evidence from the fossils tell us this. Based on the evidence that we have that is available to us, the first people of the Americas were black people, okay? And then you also have African, you have a series of migrations, and you have African people who have a fundamental impact on classical American civilization. The greatest of those civilizations is called the Olmec civilization. And the Olmec civilization, O-L-M-E-C, is important to us because it's the parent civilization of the Americas. It took place in what is now Mexico, beginning about 4,000 years ago. And I'm not saying that the Olmec were African people, but at the very least, there was an African hierarchy. Africans were at the vanguard of Olmec civilization. African people traveled all over the world in ancient times, but they didn't go to rob and rape and steal and pillage and take other people's things. They came and they brought gifts. They showed how to make life better and easier and more productive. And as a result of that, they were treated in large measure like royalty. And you can find it among the Olmec. You can see it among the Moors in Spain, just to use two examples. Now, the Olmec civilization, what stands out most about them are these massive stone heads. There are 20 of them. I've seen every one of them, photographed every one of them. And they all have the features of an African. And they are all at least on the average 3,000 years old. And so it's clear that our history in the Americas does not start with enslavement. The problem is with some of the things that people are saying in social media is that they are saying that we are the direct descendants of those ancient Africans. And I think that is where I begin to fundamentally disagree. African people have been the first people in every continent, but you cannot deny the horrors and the existence of the transatlantic slave trade. So history is the movements of people, and African people have been coming to the Americas for tens of thousands of years before slavery. So that's what I would say about the Americas.
Well, aren't the Olmec from Mali?
No. You don't know, there are many different migrations. For example, there's a migration I guess we could call it that, during the time of the Mali Empire. You have a sultan of the Mali Empire named Abubakar II, and he's the predecessor of the much more famous man called Mansa Musa. And according to tradition, Abubakar II built a fleet of ships, more than one, and sailed to the Americas more than 800 years ago. This is long after the Olmec civilization. So that's what I meant when I said you have different migrations from Africa coming to the Americas in ancient times. The Olmec, the African presence among the Olmec is much earlier than that.
So it's not necessarily, I guess the best way to say it, it's not necessarily proven that the Olmec are from Mali. They're just indigenous to the Americas.
No, the Olmec are definitely not from Mali. There's no connection.
Would it be safe to say that they are from the African continent? Because, I mean, their features is just, they look like some people I know from Benin.
No, you really, honestly, you can't even say that. What you can say is that at a certain time in the history of the Olmec civilization, a small group of African people appeared that sailed across the Atlantic Ocean from Africa. Either by design, or maybe they were just on a ship that got caught up on a current and took them across the Atlantic. And these African people were probably from the Nile Valley, from Kemet and Kush. And those were the ones who impacted Olmec civilization. The Olmec civilization, I do not believe, were black people any more than the United States is a black country, in spite of the fact that we had an African-American president. And an African-American first lady, and an African-American, in fact, two African-American attorney generals, both of them, Eric Holder and Loretta Lynch, who were married to black, who had black mates. Even though you had a black national security advisor, even though we have LeBron and Oprah and Beyonce, that doesn't mean the United States is a black country. It means that the United States is a country in which black people have excelled on many levels. I would say the same thing about the Olmec civilization, that perhaps the kings of the ancient Olmec world were African, but that for the most part, the Olmec civilization was a Native American civilization, whatever the Native Americans may have looked like 4,000 years ago. That's what I would say. Does that make sense?
Yes, exactly.
All right. That was easy. You're not going to put up a fight? You're not going to battle? Wow, that was easy.
Mm-hmm. No, because I understand it. I get it. I understand it perfectly clear.
Very good. You know what they say. If you teach a woman or reach a woman, you teach a nation. If you teach a man, you reach an individual. I think my brother put it earlier, put it pretty well. I love to talk about black women. Black women are so special. The black woman is truly the mother of humanity and the mother of civilization. And there are not enough words that we can express to show the admiration and love that we have for black women. I salute you.
And I'm so greatly appreciative that you said that. Thank you so much.
And I feel the same way.
See?
Thank you so much. That's just like, you just, my cup runneth over. My cup is running over right now. You can keep talking. Keep talking and talk.
You know, we'll have to do another program on that. We'll have to do something on black women in history. Or the role of the African woman, you know, over the centuries. One of the most interesting things, if we were going to talk, let's say, for example, about the African presence in Europe, we could talk about the black Madonnas or the black virgins. These are icons and statues of the Virgin Mary and the infant Jesus painted black. Now, why would they be painted black? Because that's a recollection, that's a reminder of the original Black Madonna, which is probably Isis and Horus, Aset and Heru. The African presence in Europe is very ancient. African people, just like America, are the first people in Europe. And you know, Europe is so close to Africa. So migrations to Africa from the beginning, and unfortunately, a lot of those early Africans got caught up in the ice and were transformed into something different. Because while I would say that there's only one race, and that's the human race, I don't think I'll ever be prepared to call to accept anyway. How do I put it? I would say humanity begins in Africa, but the people I consider African are black people, if that makes sense. So I think that the original African who went into Europe was transformed into something quite different. And that's who we're trying to grapple with today. But even historically, you have, before I get to the Black Madonnas, just for a moment, you have African people in the Roman Empire. You have at least there's an African dynasty at the height of Imperial Rome. You have African popes, African gladiators, African saints, African martyrs in the Colosseum, African senators. You have one of the greatest writers in the history of Rome who is an African, a man named Terence Afar. And he is the person that said, and this sounds like something a brother would say, where there is life, there's hope. And he's the one who said, I am a man, and therefore nothing human is alien to me. And then you have Africans in Greek mythology. And then, of course, you have the people called the Moors. The word Moor means black. And these were black people, in this case Muslims, who went into Spain in the 8th century and took Europe out of the, quote-unquote, Dark Ages. And the word Moor literally means black. It means scorched. But you also have in Europe the Black Madonnas, and these are religious icons. And they're the most venerated icons in Europe today. And they are depictions of black women with child. And they are considered to be miracle workers. And they are the superstars of what we might call the cult. How do we put it? They are superstars of the cult of Mary. And these black images, or images of black women, are particularly in the southern and eastern parts of Europe. There are more than 60 of them in France alone. And they are considered miracle workers. So black women, very important, very, very special. And we have a history that's barely been told. You have a black knight at King Arthur's Round Table. You have black people historically or in the mythology of Ireland and Scotland and Wales. You have black saints in Germany like Saint Maurice. So it's really, really an amazing story. And I think that if we could reach our people with this story, it would transform everything. We have to make our people interested in wanting to know who they are and what they've done. And so therefore, I think, you know, we have to find different ways to do it. We have to be visual. We have to be creative. So anyway, there's a little bit about the African presence in Europe and about the Black Madonna in Europe.
Well, what about Sertimus? Was Sertimus born in Europe or was he born in North Africa?
Septimius Severus?
Yes, Septimius.
You mean the African? Yes, Septimius Severus is an African-born emperor of Rome. He's born in Libya in 146, and I think April 9th, 146, I believe. And he becomes emperor of Rome in the year 193. And he remains emperor of Rome until the year 211. So he is the founder of an African dynasty at the height of the Roman Empire. And as I say, you have three African popes. You have a man named Saint Victor I, who is responsible for Easter being celebrated on Sunday every year. You have an African named Saint Gelasius, and you have an African pope named Saint Miltiades. You have several African saints. You have a saint named Saint Augustine. If I'm not mistaken, Saint Augustine there in Florida is the first city in the modern American sphere. It was built largely by enslaved Africans, and it's named after an African saint who is the greatest saint in the history of the Catholic world. So there's so much history there. And it's not hidden. We just have to be willing to look for it. Now, if I post on Facebook, and I spend a lot of time on Facebook, I like to call myself sometimes the Pharaoh of Facebook. If I post these things, people would say, oh, we've been lied to. They didn't tell us. This is true. But whose job is it for us to know our history? And whose job is it for us to tell our story without apologizing, without stuttering, without stammering, without feeling like I'm going to hurt somebody's feelings? And if we don't do that, whose fault is that?
Our fault. It's our time to find out who we are and where we come from, because we already know during slavery we were being killed if we was reading and writing. They purposely took our history books from us and made us think we were nothing. So to say they didn't teach us that, you know, it's like, of course they didn't. Did you expect them to?
Well, apparently we do. You know, I think we've outsourced the teaching of our history, and we expect other people to do it, to take care of it. I don't know if that's a sense of inferiority or, you know, a sign that we've been under the oppression of other people for a long time. In the early part of the program, my brother asked, why isn't Runoko Rashidi's work being financed by our community? And why doesn't he get more lectures, and why isn't he interviewed for the movies and what have you? Because we haven't demanded that. Again, we are in an early, it's almost as though a lot of us are still asleep, and we're just kind of awaking from a slumber, and we haven't quite figured it out yet. You know, people tell me I'm great all the time. But rarely does anybody say, Dr. Rashidi, what do you need? How can I help? What do you want me to do? What is my assignment? I think we're just kind of used to people spoon-feeding us, and we have to get out of that mentality.
Wow, you just said a mouthful. You know, you just said a mouthful, and that is the soul truth, for real. It's like they think that you don't have needs too, like you don't need help either, you know, to think that you can just always feed me and then I'm not giving back. You know, that's being selfish in a sense, but not on purpose. You know, they're subliminally being selfish, like, oh, I can just have him feed me and feed me, and I'll never say, are you hungry? Do you need something to drink?
No, that drives me crazy. It really, really, I tell you what, really, it's subject to get you kicked off my Facebook page real quick. If I go somewhere, and I'm traveling all the time, I've been to 121 countries now in the last 20 years. That's a lot.
Yeah.
And I'll go somewhere, and I'll post on Facebook, because I'll be telling most of my business on Facebook anyway. And I would say, I'm going to the North Pole. I found some black people up there. I'm going to the North Pole. Let's just say I'm saying that on Facebook. Somebody will post, send us the pictures, please, or more pics, please. And then I'm furious because I want to say, Negro, have you contributed $5 for a camera or an admission fee to the museum or something that's going to help with the plane fare or the bus fare or the taxi fare? But you're saying, more pics, please. What is your contribution? What you going to do? Now, that really drives me crazy. I must confess.
You know, and that's a reply that I would love to say. Send the film and the camera, and I'll send you all the pictures you could ever want. Send the camera and send the film.
Exactly.
Yeah, black folks.
I'll send you all the pictures.
Send some pictures. That's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's the way we are. So I love black people, but black people, we are a badly damaged people. You know, one of the worst. Now, here's another bad one right now. Now, look, a few months ago, I took a group to Ethiopia and Kenya, And while I had a nice group, about 14, 15 people to Kenya, people that I've traveled with before, people that I like a lot. So anyway, we're staying in a nice hotel in Nairobi, the capital of Kenya, and there's a department store downstairs. It's like the hotel is on top of a shopping mall. So one of the sisters in my group went downstairs to one of the department stores underneath the hotel. And she's an African-American sister, and all the employees in the store were black. Everybody was black. So she went in there and she said, I would like to buy a black doll for my niece. Do you have any black dolls? And this is an African now. And the people in the store started laughing. The idea that somebody would want a black doll was like incomprehensible to them. Mm-hmm. Now, this brings me to mind one of the worst aspects of it, and you could really tell. I think we're all familiar with the black doll, white doll test, where in 1954, the year I was born, a black psychologist named Kenneth Clark, a brother from Panama, administered a test, and he gave a group of black children, a choice: do you want to play with a white doll or the black doll? And as you know, most of the children went with the white doll. And when they were asked why, because it's pretty. But that was 1954. That was 64 years ago. But the same test was done a few years ago again, and results were even worse. Most of the children, the black children, wanted the white doll. And when asked why, because it's pretty. And the person would say, but the black doll looks like you. I know, but the white doll is pretty. Now, that's deep. This is in the United States. But I dare say, if you went to Africa or Brazil or even Jamaica, I wonder if the results wouldn't be even worse. What do you guys think?
Yep. It would be the same result. Yep. They want the white doll.
I think the results would be worse.
But you know what?
When I'm in Africa, I've been to – let me make this last little comment about that. I've been to 54 countries in Africa. I'm sorry. There are 54 countries in Africa. I've been to 33. And I don't know if I've ever seen a black doll in Africa. You know what else you see a lot of in the motherland? Places like Ghana, Nigeria. White Jesus. Everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
On the bus stops. On the buses, in the taxi.
It's depressing. Yes.
It's depressing.
I went to Ghana in 2012, and that was the downside of it. I'm seeing big bulletin boards with the pastor advertising his church. He has his picture on the left, a big bulletin board where I know he spent plenty of money. A big bulletin board. His face is on the left, and the white Jesus with blue eyes and blonde hair on the right.
The white Jesus? Are you kidding?
Just like that.
Isn't Jesus, I guess I'm joking. Anyway, I'll just leave that alone. But it's sad, but you could go to Jamaica, or you could go to Haiti, or you could go to Brazil, or you could go to Australia, or you could go to the Black Islands of the Pacific and see the exact same thing.
Foolishness.
You know what else you see in a lot of parts of Africa? I don't know if I would say Ghana, but some of the French parts of Africa, the weaves and the wigs. And we haven't even talked about the bleaching creams.
Oh, please. They bleaching in Ghana, and they're wearing weaves in Ghana, too. They don't like that.
Yeah, but I tell you. Yeah, but I think some parts of Africa, I think, is worse than other parts. I think the Francophone parts of Africa are the worst, because the French, I think, colonized our minds even more than the British did. Now, you can tell me if I'm wrong or not, but I don't ever recall anybody from Ghana or Nigeria or Jamaica saying I'm British. But I meet black folk all the time who say I'm French. Do you really?
Well, I met a Ghanaian sister that said that she was British.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Uh-oh.
If you look
she
at
lived
Ghanaian,
in England
brother,
for some years and traveled back and forth to Ghana. You know, back and forth home, but she spent a lot of time in Britain and in London, and she just got used to that atmosphere and that environment, and she became a product of it, and she told me she was British.
Well,
and was always talking about going back to London. Just got back home and already planning and talking about going back.
Can anybody find something positive to say as we are winding down to the end of the show? Can we maybe concentrate on something uplifting?
I mean,
for
it
our
does
people.
Seem negative, but it's a negative truth. You know, it's true.
It is.
It's not like, you know, that was my experience, me personally visiting Ghana for those 7.5 weeks that I was there in 2012. That was the downside, to see the conditioning and the brainwash. I thought we were damaged over here, but the damage is beyond damage there, because at least we have ones like you, myself, Brother Lance, Brother Keston on the phone, and other ones that's listening that know how to rise up out of certain brainwashing and sleeping. They'll just sleep on purpose. They want to be asleep. They'll get mad if you tell them that Jesus is not, if Jesus did exist, he wouldn't
exactly.
be white.
Exactly.
They'll fight you. They'll try to hurt you. My neighbor almost cut me in the corner. Mm-hmm.
Listen to this. You heard, tell me I'm wrong.
Go ahead.
I think this might have happened when I wasn't in the United States. So I want you to correct me. A couple months ago, a sister got beat up or assaulted by a Korean owner of a hair care place, if I'm not mistaken. He actually physically hit her. And so people in our community decided, we're going to boycott this place. And the Africans were having a boycott. And the Korean business owner reduced the prices of the products by 50%. And that broke the boycott. As a matter of fact, the brother who was the head of the boycott, I think, was assaulted by one of the protesters who wanted to go in and buy the hair care products. How could they lose on that 50% discount? Did you hear that story?
Yeah. No, I never heard this story. I never heard it. And I'm glad this was my first time hearing it, because I might have would have cried reading it. So what was the protest about? Getting a discount?
Hey, they were gonna say... The protest was, we can't have this level of, hey, somebody assaulted a sister in our community. Sister went in the store and got in an argument about the price or something, and the guy actually hit her. And so they're saying, we're going to close this store down. We're going to close this business down. And they have people picketing the place, and the guy reduced the prices of the hair care products by 50%, and they said, later for the boycott, later for the protest, I'm going to go get some of this hair care product. That was what it was about. The revolution. The revolution must begin in the mind. You know, we have to define what is beautiful. And we have to define what is happiness and what is successful. Stop using words like fair skin. And stop using words like good hair.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to features that are not typically African. When we say fair skin, we're usually talking about somebody with light complexion. And when we say good hair, we're typically talking about long, straight hair. And most of us are not born with that. So, I mean, these are the kinds of things that we have to work on. And it's going to be a long time. It's going to be a long time. We have to get used to that. But we can't stop. We have to keep pushing. And you know, I guess our ancestors will judge us. I believe that at some point in time, we're all going to meet the ancestors. We're going to stand, this is my vision anyway, that we're going to stand before our ancestors. They're going to say, Runoko Rashidi, step forward. What did you do to advance the cause of your people? I hope to be able to say, to tell Chancellor Williams and Ivan Van Sertima and Malcolm X and Marcus Garvey and Harriet Tubman and Nzinga and Lumumba, I did this. I did this, I did that. And I hope they will say, come forward, my brother. So what will the ancestors say about us? And how will they judge us? And I try to use this as a guide. I try to ask myself, would the ancestors be proud of what I'm doing? You know, will I be able to say that I made the world a better place? That I made every effort to uplift, or at least a healthy effort, to uplift my community? That I sacrificed, you know, so that my ancestors, so that future generations would have a better and easier, a more productive, a more elevated life? I think these are important questions. What will your statement in life be? And how will future generations look at you? When I do presentations, as you know, I show pictures of Imhotep and African kings and queens who lived thousands of years ago. And I challenge people with the question, what will future generations say about you? Will you be looked upon as a valued ancestor, as a person who made real contributions, or will they say you were just another trifling Negro who took up space? I want to be able to say that I did something of great value, and I made a contribution to that advanced the cause of my people.
Right. I want to be able to say, well, I had ones like Dr. Runoko Rashidi come on the radio, and he tried to wake up the sleeping giants, the ones that refused to come off zombie mode. You know, can I step up?
I don't know what they're going to say about that, sister. They may say, we're going to have to give that some thought. We'll get back with you on that. They
so
might say you meant well.
Right.
I hope so.
Your track record will suffice my radio program.
I love black people. I love black folk. And I don't apologize for that. I don't hate anybody. But I love black people. In spite of all our problems, in spite of all our issues, I love my people. And that makes a difference, too. You know, that I love what I do. It's hard work. It requires a lot of sacrifice. But I feel blessed. I feel fortunate to be a historian. I love it.
Well, we appreciate
like
you totally.
You love what you do.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Lance.
No, I was just going to say we appreciate you totally because many people will enjoy the results, but they won't understand the tireless effort that it takes day in and day out, week in and week out, month in and month out, year, decades, and when nobody else is around. And remember, you said it was 40 years, 45 years? Well,
45 years, my brother.
I'm quite, yes, 45 years, okay. Now, it's easy now to go on Google and pull stuff up. I remember doing book reports in school, and these kids have it so easy. They can just search something and pull up information, copy and paste and turn a few words around. But when you said 45 years, what most people have to understand is that you had to get up sometimes and go to that library. You started this at a time where there were no computers as they are now, and that took a love at that particular time. And if we're as blinded as we are now, imagine how many people did not understand what it was that you were doing when you had the vision and the wherewithal and the drive to see something that the other world, rest of the world, didn't see. Because our culture is being hijacked now. Our history is being turned around. And like you said, it's not their responsibility to find certain things out. But now that we've been moving away from the printed word in a book, and most of our younger folks and many of our older folks are depending on Google and the various search engines, they don't realize that the internet is only as good as what you upload, you see? And many things are being manipulated. And we're getting away from books. We're getting away from the oral history. We're getting away from the documentation that we do for ourselves to preserve our story. So you with those pictures and all this information you have, you need to come down to Florida so we can really vibe on that on a regular basis and on the shows over the line. Because, again, if it's not for the work that you've done, I'm quite sure a lot will be lost, not just the research through books, but the traveling all over the world and the stories that you can share because you were there. Too many of us cut the TV on and have somebody who doesn't look like us tell a story about us that's slanted to favor him or her as the hero who rides off into the sunset. So that's why it's important that we support individuals like yourself because you're driven by love. I noticed you said that several times during this program, and that says a lot about you. It's not a profit thing like some other explorer or historian may go and get funded by a university to go and do certain things while they're in a 5-star hotel. You're doing this out of love. Sometimes I'm quite sure there was a hunger in your belly. Sometimes I'm quite sure there might have been a bill that you didn't know how you were going to pay, but you still did what you did, and you made it this far. And for that, I say I appreciate you 100% totally. I could never thank you enough.
Well, I thank you for that, although I must confess I love 5-star hotels, man. I love whenever possible.
I'm not knocking you. I'm not knocking you. No, you're supposed to be in a five-star hotel.
No, I hear what you're saying, man. I hear you.
While in a five-star hotel, I know you were up at night researching something, so you still had to drive no matter where you are.
Oh, yeah. I love what I do. So anyway, I appreciate you all. Let me give my contact information for anybody who might want it and be listening. You can always go to my website, which is drrunoko.com, drrunoko.com, drrunoko.com. Or you can call me if you like after the show. My phone number is area code 323-803-8663. That's 323-803-8663. And the easiest thing, you can always email me at runoko@hotmail.com. And again, my name is spelled runoko@hotmail.com. I give group tours to Africa and other parts of the world. I have a series of books and DVDs for sale. If you want to make a contribution to the website, if you want to go to the website and see my bio, perhaps consider inviting me to where you are to show some of these pictures and to tell our story. Again, you can get all that information on my website, which is Dr. Runoko, one word, Dr. Runoko, drrunoko.com.
Yes, I'm on your website right now.
All right.
And then we also probably need to have another off-the-air conversation on having you come to Miami or Orlando.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm always game for that. You know, I love to share. I think what a lot of people are not able to appreciate just listening to the show is that I really try to do very visual presentations. I have a lot of original photographs. We haven't talked about, for example, black people in places like ancient China, Japan, Southeast Asia, the Arabian Peninsula, Iraq, Iran. We haven't talked about the black presence in the islands of the South Pacific. Sisters and brothers from places like Fiji who proudly say they're African or they come from Africa. And then there are these fascinating sisters and brothers in Australia who left Africa perhaps 100,000 years ago. So we have a vast story, a story that's barely been told. And I appreciate you all giving me an opportunity to share a little bit of that story with you.
And I definitely appreciate you taking out your time and your energy to be on the program and also willing to come back again. That is just, you know, my cup running over all over again. I put another cup out and you got that overflowing. So, you know, it's
all right.
always a grand, you know, appreciation to have ones like your spirit on the airwaves to, you know, dialogue with and learn from, because I'm always ever learning. I'm always open to ask questions and, you know, just always on the learning train. You never stop learning. As long as you're living and you're growing, you're always going to be learning.
Well, I think when you stop learning is when you start to die. And that means that I'm going to live forever. Because, you know, it's one thing not to know, but it's another thing not to care. And I definitely care, and I love our people. So, again, I want to thank you all for having me. I know we're about out of time. If you are into the holidays, whatever holidays they may be, enjoy. Enjoy this special time of the year, the end of the year, and, you know, all the best. As they used to say in Kemet, may you fly on the wings of Ma'at and have blessings without number. So you all stay strong, and I look forward to the next time.
Thank you.
Yes, thank
Hotel.
You
so much.
Thank
we'll
you.
Be reaching out to you. Definitely.
I look forward to it. Be strong. Bye-bye.
That was wonderful.
Yes. That was beautiful. And you know, we were talking like, you know, we know each other already. You know, we started getting comfortable with each other, which is good, you know?
Right. Well, it's a common spirit. And, you know, he didn't detect any negativity because he wouldn't, because we're of the same, we're the same spirit, the same bloodline. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's going to be an agreeable conversation. It's not going to be anything or any challenges or any arguing, because I'm quite sure he made a mention, like, wow, you know, nobody's debating, nobody, because I'm quite sure he has had to deal with that from that type of mindset.
There's nothing to debate.
Individuals who don't want to accept what he has to say. Say it again, sister.
No, I was saying there was nothing really to debate, because everything he was saying was common sense. You know, you turn on your common sense, you can relate to him.
Exactly. Exactly. I remember, and I wanted to add in, Brother Keston and I were at a I don't want to say the name because of the story I'm telling, but we were at a gathering, and people were expressing their opinions. And there was a gentleman from Africa who didn't like what Brother Keston was saying about, you know, colonization and the European takeover and the many aspects of our life, especially with religion. And he got so upset to see this man. He was piping hot. He didn't even know how to handle. But the reaction to me let me know that he knew what Brother Keston was saying is the truth. And he made an attempt to salvage what little darkness that he had in his mind by getting up in the front, and he grabbed the Bible, and he said, you know, Brother Keston made his point, and he had moved on. And this guy is just quoting out scriptures and trying to piece together some type of counterattack, but he couldn't, and he was looking around. Nobody was really paying no mind, because it was evident, you know, that his mind was taken over by something that wasn't in favor of him because of the way he looked. And it's true. There are many people from the continent of Africa, brothers and sisters, that mm-hmm. are lost. Like I said, it's crazy how they try to emulate. Yeah, they try to emulate the British and the American way, Caucasian mm-hmm. way of doing things. Like I said, a lot of websites that I travel to go and look at stuff, I don't stay on too long because, like, this is the same rehashed mentality. How about the girl, mm-hmm. I don't know if she's a celebrity or an entertainer, named Denisha. And she has this bleaching cream that's very popular. She went from mm-hmm. an extremely melanated skin to extremely white complexion. No, it's definitely going to make her sick. Definitely going to make her sick. Mm-hmm. It's the most extreme transition that I've seen. And I mean, yeah, of course. You know, I know a person who is in, you know, funeral home mortician, and they told me that, you know, when certain bodies, certain up under the scalp, up under the skin and the scalp, green and rotten from the relaxing cream that's used over the years. And I've also read you know, you understand that everything that you eat and consume, your kidneys have to deal with it if it's something beyond the scope of what's natural. It's natural, mm-hmm. it's not a problem. Mm-hmm. But if it's not natural, and see, also it's topical. It's not just what you eat, it's what you put into your skin. The skin is the largest organ on the human body, and you absorb things. So you're putting this stuff in your scalp, you're putting these things on your skin, and mm-hmm. your internal organs have to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
You see? So many of us don't realize that. And we're going for this quest of, in the quest of, oh, we got to be beautiful. Who says that's beautiful? That's frightening to me. In all honesty,
right?
It's frightening.
Right. It is,
you know,
scary.
I turn the corner on,
they do look
late
scary.
At night, she's looking at me. You know what I mean?
Right.
I say, oh my God.
I was doing some research on this skin bleaching, and from my research, it says out of the whole world, Nigeria is the number one country for skin bleaching.
Yeah.
And when you're dealing with the Western Hemisphere, Jamaica was number one. Well, Nigeria and Jamaica,
they're
top rated with skin bleaching. And then I went deeper into the research where the Ministry of Health had to come in Nigeria and into Jamaica because the skin bleaching was getting so out of hand that, you know, it was they was trying to make people understand that there's health issues behind that. You can get cancer of the liver, cancer of the skin. You know, just over time, you're going to be regretting that you ever did this because you're going to start getting sicknesses that you're not going to think that it's the skin bleaching.